Hi folks, Dr. Chapman here. Today we're going to visit Joshua Tree National Park and explore shear zones, the tectonic fate of California, and the connection between granite and French fries. Joshua Tree National Park is chiefly composed of intrusive igneous rocks that are part of the coastal Cordilleran batholiths. These batholiths are the remnants of the Mesozoic continental arc and include the Sierra Nevada to the north and the peninsular ranges to the south. The batholiths were likely once connected, but they were sliced in two and disrupted by the San Andreas Fault that cuts between them. Joshua Tree National Park is located right where the fault cuts through, in a region called the Eastern Transverse Ranges. They're called the Transverse Ranges because they trend east-west, perpendicular to most of the other mountain ranges in California, like the Sierra Nevada, which runs north-south.
I have a compass. Follow me.
These mountains were not always oriented east-west, though. Paleomagnetic data suggests that the transverse ranges were rotated by the San Andreas and other faults in the area. The San Andreas is nominally the boundary between the North American plate and the Pacific plate. However, this boundary is not a single fault, but more of a wide zone of distributed deformation made up of faults and small crustal blocks between the faults, called a shear zone. Joshua Tree is in the southern part of a feature called the Eastern California Shear Zone. If geologists started calling it the Eastern California Shear Zone mega awesome, they could use the acronym EXIMA.
That's the worst idea I've ever heard.
Just a thought.
The worst idea.
The Eastern California Shear Zone is about 125 kilometers wide and has an overall right lateral sense of motion. Meaning if you are standing on one side of the fault looking across to the other side, it's moving to your right. As the edges of the shear zone move, faults within the shear zone accommodate the motion, and the blocks within the shear zone are rotated and tilted. Almost all of the faults in the Eastern California Shear Zone are currently active and produce small earthquakes every day. The last really big earthquake in the national park was in 1992 with the magnitude 6.1 Joshua Tree earthquake, followed a couple months later by the magnitude 7.3 Landers earthquake, whose epicenter was located just north of the park. One of the coolest things about the Eastern California Shear Zone is that it might represent the birth of a new plate boundary.
Cool, but not that cool.
Some geoscientists suspect that in the future, a new plate boundary may form inland of the San Andreas Fault, on the eastern side of the Sierra Nevada Mountains. GPS data shows that this region is moving about 1 centimeter per year. That's a third as fast as the main San Andreas Fault. It's not too hard to imagine that the existing faults in Eastern California may start to link up with one another and form one major through-going fault system. If you've ever heard the myth that California will one day fall into the sea or fall into the ocean, this scenario with a new plate boundary forming in Eastern California might be the closest to reality, but you'll need to wait around 15 million years. The new fault system appears to splay off the main San Andreas Fault in the vicinity of Joshua Tree National Park. The jostling of the crustal blocks in the park has caused the west side of the park, the side closest to the San Andreas Fault, to be uplifted and tilted. The igneous rocks in the west side of the park were once located around 20 kilometers deep inside the earth, while the igneous rocks on the east side of the park were located around 5 kilometers. Geologists call this type of exposure a crustal section because it's like taking a slice or cross section into the earth. Tilted crustal sections like Joshua Tree provide invaluable information on what continental arcs look like inside of the Earth.
We're surrounded by liquid hot magma.
Most visitors to Joshua Tree do not come to see fault scarps or crustal sections. They come to see the fantastical rock shapes, features like skull rock. The rock shapes are a product of mechanical and chemical weathering and erosion. Erosion and weathering are often conflated, but weathering breaks down rocks in place with little to no movement, while erosion involves the movement and transport of rocks and sediment. Mechanical weathering forcibly breaks apart rocks and grinds them down into smaller sizes. This can be achieved through roots growing into cracks, the thermal expansion and contraction with temperature changes, and from the release of pressure as rocks are exhumed towards the surface. The most common form of mechanical weathering is the abrasion of rock by wind, water, or ice that is laden with sand and other smaller rocks. The most common types of chemical weathering are dissolution, like dissolving limestone in a slightly acidic rainwater, oxidation, which gives iron-rich rocks their rusty color, and hydrolysis, which is particularly important at places like Joshua Tree, where the dominant rock type is granitic. Actually, Joshua Tree National Park is a good proxy for the average composition of the continental crust globally, which is also granitic. Continental crust and the rocks at Joshua Tree are chiefly composed of feldspar, mainly the plagioclase variety. So let's consider the chemical weathering of plagioclase by hydrolysis. The mineral formula for plagioclase is NaAlSi3O8. For the hydrolysis reaction to balance, we'll need two plagioclase formulas and double our number of ions. To this, we'll add water, which of course is H2O. Most rainwater and groundwater is slightly acidic, so we'll also add a couple extra hydrogen ions to lower the pH level. Okay, this is where the magic happens. When the acidic water is added, the plagioclase crystal is hydrated, and hydroxyl or OH groups form. This is where the hydrolysis process gets its name. This helps break apart the mineral into more basic, stable components like quartz, which is SiO2. An easy way to think about this is that basic quartz sand is a feldspar weathering byproduct. Hydrolysis also frees up the sodium ions, which are dissolved into the groundwater or surface waters. What you have left over is a new mineral with the formula Al2Si2O5OH4. This is the mineral kaolinite, and it's a very common type of clay. So starting with feldspar and water, we ended up with clay, quartz, sand, and dissolved sodium ions.
It's basic chemistry, yo.
Water is able to seep into tiny pore spaces in the outer surface of rocks. And because the hydrated clay mineral kaolinite expands and takes up more space than the original feldspar crystal, hydrolysis can actually break apart rocks and reveal more fresh mineral surface area to weather. The process ends up rounding off sharp edges and corners, and the end result is the rounded forms you see in Joshua Tree National Park. What is even more awesome is that this entire process likely took place underground. The modern, dry, arid climate of Joshua Tree National Park was established about 1 million years ago during the Pleistocene epoch. Prior to that time, the region was much wetter and cooler, and the landscape consisted of rolling green hills with a thick soil mantle. The weathering and rounding of granite took place in the soil. As the climate changed and the vegetation thinned out, the area was more prone to erosion, and the granite shapes buried beneath the ground were unearthed. For this reason, geologists sometimes call Joshua Tree National Park a fossil landscape. I mentioned that hydrolysis of feldspar ends up releasing sodium ions into water. These positively charged cations will be looking for something to bond with in order to have a neutral charge. Sodium's favorite bonding target is chlorine. The atmosphere and all the surface waters on Earth have trace amounts of chlorine, mainly produced in volcanic eruptions. Sodium bonding with chlorine produces NaCl, which is salt. This salt makes its way from the granitic outcrop into streams and then rivers and eventually makes its way into the ocean. The reason the oceans are salty is because of the weathering of continental crust, which is predominantly made of feldspar.
Salty.
Around 1900, geologist John Jolly estimated the age of the Earth to be about 100 million years old by using the amount of salt in all the major rivers on Earth and calculating how long it would take for enough salt to build up into the oceans to match its current level of saltiness. Jolly was only off by about 4.5 billion years.
Not even close.
Mainly because he underestimated how deep the oceans are. He didn't accurately account for the evaporation of seawater and the formation of rock salt. He didn't know about plate tectonics, which recycles rocks. Next time you reach for the salt shaker, remember that some random feldspar crystal in a nameless granitic rock in a faraway mountain range somewhere gave up its sodium ions for you. And some volcano somewhere else on Earth spouted chlorine to the atmosphere, or it swirled around until it found its sodium soulmate, and they bonded and evaporated and ended up on your French fries. Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.